Well, I am really excited here. This is going to be right at the top of my favorite guests. We've had on everyone from, what, Vince Dooley to Steve Spurrier to John Feinstein to Mr. Jennings. Steve Forbes, when he was taking the Bucks to the NCAA tournament, was a weekly guest here. But this one's going to be a little special for me. Ricky Rockman during the spring race. That's another. We're going to be putting pop culture to NASCAR like we did with Ricky Rockman. My guest today is Guy Waldron, who, well, I guess it was about 40 years ago, created a TV show that we're all very, very familiar with in East Tennessee. My all-time favorite, The Dukes of Hazzard. It was set in the South, which I had never seen a show set in the South before, except maybe the Waltons when I was a little boy. But the Dukes had adventure, and it had cars, and that was so much fun. It also debuted on the Columbia Broadcasting System about 3 weeks before the famous 1979 Daytona 500, which ended in a wreck that, you know, Bobby Allison and Cale Yarborough got into a fight. Richard Petty was able to win it. Dale Earnhardt made his first strong showing. And it was a circumstance also where the race was shown for the first time live on network TV. So I want to ask you, Guy Waldron, if I can take you back to that time. I do think there's a relationship with this show, which was a top five, sometimes even number one ranked show in its heyday. And NASCAR is taking off in popularity at the same time. Yourself as the creator of the show, what relationship do you think your creation, The Dukes of Hazzard, had in promoting NASCAR racing, if any?
Well, I'm not sure. I can say this, that the Dukes fans and the NASCAR fans and racing fans were all of the same people. They liked country music. Not everyone was a country music fan, but as soon as NASCAR got cooking and all the different races got going, like the Daytona 500 and so on, the Dukes people were right in the middle. As, in terms of Dukes, we used that because we were, for example, at the end of Dukes, the very last episode, we established that John Schneider, Bo Duke, was going to try to, he was going to leave Hazzard County. He was going to go out and try to get on the racing circuit, and his dream of life was to become a NASCAR driver. And that's where we left it. He took off to play, to drive for NASCAR. So NASCAR has always been an important part of Dukes, and that we could always use it in the background. We could always refer to it. And, of course, we had a lot of fun with the fact that some of the first moonshine drivers had become great race drivers, like Junior Johnson and so on. So by playing off of that, we were locked in with the racing world, and of course that's when NASCAR really took off.
Well, I want to ask you, I mentioned the correlation, the timeline between the very first episode of the show and also the first airing of the Daytona 500 on CBS. And of course, that was a race where, you know, Jimmy Carter attended that race. I think it was the first time a sitting president had ever gone to a stock car race.
Probably, yes.
I wanted to point this out, but, you know, Cale Yarborough, you know, he lost the fight with Bobby Allison. He wasn't looking real good in the PR circumstance at that time. The very next season, that fall, when Dukes had been picked up for its second season, Cale Yarborough made a guest starring appearance on the show. Did how did that come about, where Cale Yarborough would was he trying to basically reestablish his image when he made this guest starring appearance?
I can't answer that for sure. What would happen with these guest cars? We had a lot of country music stars and stuff like that. They would give us a call if they were going to be in California where we could use them. And of course, they knew we liked to pull people in, country music people, and in this case, the drivers. So I don't know whether we contacted him or he contacted us. The point being is we were always open to meeting with any of these people who were part of the country music world or the Dukes world or the racing world. So how he got in there, I'm not sure. It could have been us calling him or he could have called us. The point being that once we heard somebody wanted to do that, we'd work him into the show. We'd give him a guest appearance or we'd end up the show They'd all be at the Boar's Nest, and they would come in, and the guests are sometime there, and we'd greet them and so on. So I'm not sure exactly how it worked, but a point being, we left our door open for anybody in the music world or the racing world.
Well, I know that you mentioned how, you know, in the plot line, when John and Tom went away on their, their strike, for basic, lack of a better term, for more royalties for the toys that were being sold at the time. And that's
right.
Actually how East Tennessee State former ETSU football player Byron Cherry, now don't look the records up, he was just a practice player, but he actually got a lead role on the show, a former ETSU drama student as Coy Duke. Anyway, we were talking about this when the show came. You mentioned how they left to join the NASCAR circuit. When they came back to the show, there was a famous episode called Undercover Dukes, I believe. It was a two-parter, and, you know, it's 80s TV of the day, you know, Bo and Luke go undercover to try to get, find... what was it, to break up a mob ring or something of this nature. But what I remember of that is that they did it, their guys was, they were stock car drivers. And if I recall correctly, Terry Labonte had a cameo, and certainly Ken Squire had a very prominent part in the episode. Although he wasn't credited, he announced the race, and you knew it was Ken Squire, who at the time was the voice of NASCAR racing. What I'm going to ask is, how did Terry Labonte come to get his cameo, or do you remember how Ken Squire was recruited for that episode?
You know, I don't know. When you get to the specifics, first, that was a long time ago.
Yeah.
and sometimes I could get them confused, but basically, sometimes they would contact us, or sometimes we would contact them. In this case, they probably contacted us, and they said, I'm going to be in California, we're going to be in the area, or they would bring to mind that some big thing had happened, either in the race world or music world, and they would want to somehow get on and promote it. So we left the door open for people like that, because that was very much our fan base. And if we could get anybody from racing, no matter what part of the racing world, we got them. We brought them in. We'd give them a small part, or sometimes they would be a narrator, or they would describe some race or something like that. There was always a way to work them in, and the thing, what that would happen is that sometimes we'd get a call that week, we'd go in and do a rewrite big enough to include them. So we had to remain terribly flexible. And so it put a real challenge on our writers and our producers, but it kept us open all the time to be ready to advertise or use these people whenever they had something to push. In this particular case, racing. And of course, we wanted to push racing anytime we could because we were in love with NASCAR. I mean, everybody was. It was just catching fire, and the racing world was just coming alive, and so we were fortunate enough to be a part of it.
Well, we're talking to Guy Waldron. It's race week here in Bristol. In fact, the truck races, they run tonight here up in Bristol. Guy Waldron created the Dukes of Hazzard way back in the 70s. It was actually, this is a little-known fact, a derivative. It was sort of a spin-off of a feature movie that you wrote and I think helped produce called Moon Runners, that a lot of people say this is where Smokey and the Bandit came from, that sort of thing. Moon Runners was, dare I say, very country, or even redneck, if you will, but a lot of the elements used in the Dukes, streamlined, of course, for network TV, were used in the movie The Moonrunners. But I wanted to ask, I mean, how did you get about to create the Dukes of Hazzard? This your signature TV show that you created. What was the process to create the show?
Well, what had happened was I had known some moonshine drivers in Atlanta, and what they did was a couple of them went on to become race drivers, and we had a racing place called Lakewood Park, and that was, they were great rider drivers going in there, so I knew them from that thing. I also had this background in moonshine driving, so I created Moon Runners, which is about moonshine drivers. When Warner Bros. Had put me under contract to do a totally different show, somebody said, well, what have you done? And I showed them Moon Motors, and they said, oh, can you make a show out of this for television? I said, can you make it funny? I said, sure. And so we became the first one-hour show with a lot of stunts, but also had a comedy base. And that's how we cranked up. That's how we kicked off.
Yeah, I know that we've talked a little bit about this before. When you originally created the show, there was a lot more realism to it, if you will.
We were rooted very much in what the moonshine world was at that time, what the drivers were. And when we made Moonrunners, it was not a comedy by any means. We dealt with the nitty-gritty of what was going on with moonshine driving at that time. And I based some of the stuff on the drivers in that show. There were moonshine drivers that I knew in Atlanta. And so, you know, it worked from that. Now, there was a hard reality in Moonrunners.
Now, I know you grew up in Kentucky, and
yes,
you actually would go as a boy. You'd see stunt shows, that sort of thing, you know, car shows, if you will, where there were, were there car jumps in those shows that you would see as a boy?
Man, they were everything. They were called hill drivers, and you'd go to the wherever there was a place they could have racing, and you would go and sit there, and you would see all these different kinds of stunts. Sometimes they would be rolls. Sometimes they would be just races, and sometimes they would try to wreck each other. It was kind of a combination way back then of a crash show where you try to destroy each other, or a racing show. And so, and as a kid, you sat there. We'd never seen anything like this. And so this was the beginning, and of course it stuck with me. And I thought, this is wonderful. So but when I finally got to the point where I could do a show, I had a pretty good background, at least in watching, and by that time I'd also done a couple of documentaries involving racing. So that was the whole background. Believe me, I'm not a race driver, but it became a part of my youth, and that kind of thing sticks with you when you're a kid.
Now, I did want to ask, now what was your hometown in Kentucky?
I was in a place called Lenoxburg, which is a very tiny town, and I lived in Covington, which is around Cincinnati.
Okay.
So I lived in the wintertime, I was in the city, in the summertime, I was in the country. And so swinging back and forth, I got to know some pretty raw country people, and some of those had been moonshine drivers way back then.
Okay. And like I said, I mean, Cincinnati, that's about 5 hours from us, and so I'm familiar with Covington. It's a very prominent suburb of Cincinnati and such. But,
right,
you know, I was corny being based because, obviously, East Tennessee, Eastern Kentucky, okay, maybe Kentucky's a little more basketball and maybe Tennessee's a little more football, but there are definite similarities between the two areas and such.
Absolutely.
And I know that one of the guys that you knew is a close friend. He's passed away, I know, but was a gentleman named Dave Johnson, who was from Elizabethton, which is right here in East Tennessee.
Bob Johnson, yeah.
Bob Johnson, I'm sorry.
He was from Elizabethton, Tennessee, yeah.
And now, I know that we've talked before, and I was telling the audience a little bit before, that if they can remember the show without the General Lee, that was kind of based on an experience that you and Bob Johnson from Elizabethton had had together. Can you elaborate a little bit about that story of Mary Kay's baby and the relationship that you and Bob Johnson had that created the episode?
Well, Bob Johnson and I used to go up into the mountains in the wintertime, and we would camp out and sleep in the snow. And the reason we did that in the winter is because those rattlesnakes go in at 50 degrees. They go inside and they hibernate. And so we would go up in the wintertime, and so we were driving along a mountain road, and we saw this woman walking, and here it is, it's night on a country road with snow on the ground. And so we pulled over, and we asked if we'd give her a ride, and she said yes, and she got in the car, and we saw she was pregnant. And we said, where are you going? I mean, it was nighttime, country road, in the mountains of North Georgia, and, you know, goodness. She said, well, I'm trying to get to Florida, and I'm going to hitchhike all the way, and I got to get there before I have this baby. And so we drove her to Atlanta, and we gave her money to get a bus so she didn't have to hitchhike. And so we were thinking, did she ever make it? Did she ever make it? So when I had Dukes, I was talking with Bob on just phone call, and I said, you remember that woman? He said, of course, how could we forget her? We said, well, we'd like to make an episode of her, and Bob and Luke will be driving along, and they'll see this woman, and they turn around, they realize they know her, and they're getting ready to give her a lift. She turns around, and she's pregnant. And so that was the story behind Mary Kay's Baby. A lot of the first 12 episodes were based upon incidences that we knew, and Mary Kay's Baby was the perfect example.
Well, I wanted to ask, were there any other adventures that you had with the Elizabeth the Native Bob Johnson that resulted in Duke's episodes that we might remember?
That was the big one, of course. We had involving Bob. Bob and I were in the same unit in the military,
mm-hmm.
and Bob was a brilliant linguist. When we were in Germany, Bob was undercover, and the Germans thought he was Dutch, and he was from Elizabeth, Tennessee.
Let me tell you something. If you live in Elizabeth, Tennessee, you've got to be a good linguist with the accents and such.
That's true. And what Bob did, and this was, I thought, was a lot of fun. We were sending sending operatives behind the Iron Curtain into Eastern Germany. And when the Hungarian Revolution broke out, they told Bob and said, "You got to go into Vienna and find our two agents." And bring them back before they get caught, because they were both German agents. And Bob, we had to send Bob because he was the only person who knew them. He could spot them. So we sent him in there, and when he came back, they said, one of the things you had taught these two guys when going over into East Germany, they said, was they always had dogs there. He says, your guys managed to avoid them. And Bob says, well, I just told him what boys would do up in Tennessee, and that is when you go into the moonshine country, so if you don't want to have the dogs, the Federals' dogs chase you, you put either, pine oil, something like that, on your boots, and the dogs don't like the smell of it, and they won't track you. And so he told this guy that. And so from that time on, when we were sending somebody behind the Iron Curtain, we used that old Tennessee trick.
So Bob Johnson with the pine oil on his boots and George Brett with the pine tar on his bat with something in common. There you go. That's the idea with the sports talk show here. Hey, I did want to ask this because I've always, I've seen, just to let people know, before Guy Waldron created the Dukes of Hazzard, he actually wrote a couple of episodes of One Day at a Time, that old TV show. And I know in one episode, speaking of the relationship with racing, Bonnie Franklin's character, Ann Romano, had a romance with a race car driver. And that was an episode, you're right. It was set in Indianapolis, let's recall. I also remember another episode, and you went to Georgia, and you just had to sneak in Fran Tarkenton's name into the script. I remember that.
I had to get Fran in there.
Yeah, I remember that as well. But I wanted to ask you about that. You're a Kentucky guy. How do you wind up going to the University of Georgia?
Well, I moved to Georgia when I stayed in Kentucky until I was 15, and then we moved to Atlanta. And so once I was in Atlanta, then I went to University of Georgia when I was going to take off and get a degree in journalism. And so I went by from Kentucky to Georgia that way.
I see. Okay, because I was trying to think, at the state school and all that, or if there was a great writing program or something at Georgia that I should know about or something of that nature.
Well, at that time, we were among the top five journalism schools in the country. If you wanted to go to journalism, if you were in the South and you wanted to write, you went to University of Georgia.
Well, there you go. That explains sort of the romanticism, therefore, then, of the Georgia Bulldogs era under Vince Dooley. If not, Wally Butts before then.
Yeah.
Wally Butts inventing the short pass, I think, in football today that Bill Walsh and others picked up. We've been talking to, I want to stick with racing, though, because it is race week in Bristol. And I do want to talk a little bit about this. The Dukes of Hazzard has gotten a little more attention, even though it hasn't been shown in reruns in a couple of years, sadly, because of the knucklehead Dylan Goof. And after that shooting incident and he was photographed with a Confederate flag, the show was taken off the air. And now there's a big animosity towards Confederate symbols and such. But what I see sometimes is by not having the Dukes of Hazzard on the air, we're losing some of the messages that you put in there. One was of anti-violence. You know, Boss Hogg was crooked, but he did not want to kill the Duke boys. He wanted to imprison them. You know, there was not going to be any violence. The Duke family, they believed in proper retaliation on property, not people. Now, we can discuss if retaliation on property is right, but that's an anti-violent message. At the same time, we look at prejudices. You know, the Duke family, there was always a saying in there. Uncle Jesse told us that a stranger was just a friend you'd never met before.
That's right.
We don't now get a chance to show future generations these lessons on TV due to the rebel flag on the car, which was very popular in the day. Do you think that those messages that you tried to incorporate into the Dukes, those positive messages, could actually outweigh Confederate imagery and maybe the show could be shown in reruns again?
Oh, I don't know whether that will happen or not, but the Confederate imagery, I mean, people have said, well, it's a Confederate flag, therefore you reproach slavery and so on. That had nothing to do with it. When I had a background, I created the background of Bo and Luke, I tried to give them the same childhood I had. And I was raised in the South, and my family fought on both sides of the war. So my family honored both the American flag and the Confederate flag, and we didn't condone slavery. That was ridiculous. What we did try to do in Dukes of Hazzard, we had, for example, we were one of the first shows to ever show when the people are getting ready to eat, they had the blessing. And I had to talk with Warner Bros. Says, why are they going to have the blessing? I said, because in the South, you have a blessing if you eat. And so all of these things, when we set forth to the networks, were things that were just typical of the South. And seeing the Confederate flag was just part of growing up. It was part of Southern heritage, had nothing to do with the Confederacy in that. We saw this as simply a symbol of Southern heritage. And the fact that it has been canceled because of that is, I think, very unfortunate. And I certainly don't condone any of the racism by any degree. In fact, on Dukes of Hazzard, we were hiring more black actors than any other show on the air at that time. And so, you know, when you try to make something out of it that it isn't, then it, you know, it just isn't true. The fact that I'm sorry that people do take offense at the flag today, and I can certainly see why. When the Klan took the flag over, they took the American flag over too. You know, so these are terrible, terrible times that we are facing with this, like the terrible things that happened in Charlottesville. Nobody is condoning that. It's horrible. And we don't at any time condone that. But it's unfortunate that the good lessons and the positive lessons that came out of Dukes are now not showing. And when we put in the idea that we were selling it to the network, we said one thing. We'll be the only show on the air where in the middle of a chase scene, the two characters, Bo and Luke, will look at each other and say, are we doing the right thing? Is this the right thing to do? And they also, if they were in question, they'd ask Uncle Jesse because he'd tell them what the right thing to do was. And so these elements are very basic. And say, yeah, they're cliches. You bet they're cliches. They're cliches because they're true.
Well, we've been talking to Guy Waldron, who created the Dukes of Hazzard back in the 70s. It is still held just very much to the heart of so many people in East Tennessee and the South, and certainly myself. I've been a huge fan since the very first airing of the show, Guy, back January 26, 1979. I can remember it. I was trying to avoid my babysitter. This came on. I was enthralled. And that was it. You had a fan for life. So, Guy, I want to thank you for being on again. And the race, well, they're racing the trucks here tonight. And it's race week in Bristol, a one-time home of Dukes Fest. I'll do a little bit about that. Guy Waldron, thanks so much for being with us, Tri-City Sports Now.
I really enjoyed it.
Oh, it's my pleasure. We continue with Tri-City Sports Now after this.
Tri-City Sports Now with Marky Billson. Weekdays beginning at noon on 1420 NBC Sports Radio Tri-Cities.
This just in. Wednesdays are no longer boring. Join 1420 NBC Sports Radio Tri-Cities every Wednesday night at the Johnson City Brewing Company Tap Room on Main Street in downtown Johnson City. Get half off your first pint, enjoy free popcorn, and cheer on America's team, the Atlanta Braves. Every Wednesday night is Braves Night at Johnson City Brewing Company on Main Street in downtown Johnson City. From your home for the Braves, 1420 NBC Sports Radio Tri-Cities, where every day is game day.
Freeze your fat away. No surgery and no downtime. In Johnson City, call 926-8813 and get your complimentary consultation so you can get bathing suit ready fast. Cool Sculpting is the easiest way to freeze fat cells and kiss them goodbye forever. And when you get a complete session of Cool Sculpting, you'll receive a free microdermabrasion or the facial of your choice, a $200 bonus. Call 926-8813. Doctor supervised with expert professional service. Cool Sculpt, 926-8813.
Hello, all you Blue Devil fans. This is Ruben Ferry, play-by-play announcer for Unicoi County Football on Blue Devil Radio. Join me and color analyst Riley Morris for Unicoi County High School Football this season. Tune in at 7 o'clock for our pregame show.
There's a lot you can do to pass some time, like running. You know, people love running. Just you, your feet pounding the pavement. Actually, running's not always fun. You know what is always fun? Keno to Go from the Tennessee Lottery. With drawings every 5 minutes, prizes up to $100,000, and the ability to watch drawings anywhere, anytime using the Tennessee Lottery app. Nothing beats the fun of Keno to Go. And it's fun whether you're alone or in a house full of friends. Fast, fun, and full of prizes. It's Keno to Go from the Tennessee Lottery. Game-changing fun. Just remember to play responsibly.
Okay, hon, we're all gassed up. I'll pay, then we'll hit the road.
Woohoo! Hey, can you grab some snacks?
Sure.
And a few waters?
On it.
And maybe some candy?
Yep. Anything else?
Ooh, you know what? New Instant Games are out, so maybe grab one of each? We'll need a little fun for the ride.
What about my mixtape?
Oh, honey, bless your heart.
Wherever this summer's last road trip takes you, take August Instant Games along for the ride. Just remember to play responsibly. The Tennessee Lottery. Game-changing fun.
WEMB Irwin. 1420 NBC Sports Radio Tri-Cities. On Facebook, Instagram, and Twitter.
Perhaps I should have gone back with Good Old Boys in this one, you know. Well, how's that for... I mean, man who created the Dukes of Hazzard. I mean, to me, that is a gentleman. I once told him this, that he was to the Dukes of Hazzard what Gene Roddenberry was to Star Trek. Gene Roddenberry, the creator of Star Trek. And in Star Trek fandom, you know, Gene Roddenberry is held in great high esteem. In Dukes fandom, I think they're so into the cars. Yeah, that's a big thing. I mean, obviously, you know, it's a... They're so into the cars that they forget about the people that created the show. And I know as time went by, there were some episodes that were very hard to believe, you know, and all that. I just said, you know, 1980s TV, early 1980s TV. There was, you know, an episode, two country boys, two farmers are going to be hired by the U.S. government with no experience to pose as NASCAR drivers to infiltrate the mob. And have a romantic relationship with the daughter of the ringleader of the mob who doesn't know anything about her father's business. Okay, yes, this is believable. We get that. You know, the ones that was not essentially how Guy eventually, or how he started writing the show. It was very much in tune to, you know, the traditional moonshine stories and all that. And like I said, they were putting in a lot of, you heard this, saying grace before meals, very much, you know, I almost hate to say Southern or, you know, country culture, because I know somewhere in the South Bronx they're saying grace before meals.